Hi, I'm Henry Segerman, and this is Six Axis Racks. So there are 4, 8, 12 sticks that are arranged around this core that has lots of gears on it. Each stick has two racks on it. So this stick here has a rack on its top, and then another rack on the inside here. So the rack on the top meshes with this gear here, while the rack on the inside meshes with these two gears here. And each stick is held in place by the other sticks. So this stick here, it can't come out this way because of these two sticks, and it can't come out vertically because of this gear here. And likewise, this stick here is holding in these two sticks. So what's going to happen when I push this stick, say, in this direction? Well, it will interface with these two gears here. So as I move this stick this way, this stick is going to go in the opposite direction, powered by those two gears. But also, as I move the stick this way, it's going to mesh with this gear. This gear is going to rotate this way, and these two sticks will move in opposite directions. And so the movement is going to get transferred around the core. This is very similar to the mechanism in these recursive racks that I made a video about recently. Again, there are racks moving in different directions that are connected by a gear in the middle. All right then, enough suspense, let's see it. So you can either hold it by the core and push and pull one of the sticks in and out. Or maybe a little bit easier is to hold two of the sticks and move them in opposite directions. Either way, all the sticks move at once and the whole thing has 1 degree of freedom. Here's a close-up of the core. I'm moving the sticks very slowly so you can see which way all of the gears and racks are moving. Again, this is all powered by moving just one of the racks. Here I've got this motion control slider to move it very slowly in a controlled way. This is one of a series of kinetic sculptures that started with Borromean racks, which has 3 parts. And then the next one was these tetrahedral racks with 4 parts. And then 5-axis racks with 5 parts. So, of course, I wanted to do more than 5. These are all symmetric in some way. So, Borromean racks has an axis of 3-fold rotational symmetry, while tetrahedral racks has the symmetry of a tetrahedron, ignoring reflections. And 5-axis racks has 5-fold rotational symmetry. With a lot of symmetry, I get a lot of bang for my buck. I only need to design 1 or 2 interactions between the parts, but then the symmetry copies those interactions all over the place. And I get a very complicated looking result without having to design that much. Let's look at tetrahedral racks more closely. Each part is made from 3 sticks. All of the sticks are the same as each other. Let's see how it has the symmetry of a tetrahedron. First, let's put a tetrahedron around it. Now let's match up this corner of this triangle of the tetrahedron with this stick. If I rotate the corner around, I get the other corners of the triangles of the tetrahedron. Rotating the sticks around in the same way gives back all of the sticks of the mechanism. Maybe surprisingly, 6-axis racks has exactly the same tetrahedral symmetry. Again, let's put a tetrahedron around it. Now let's match up this corner of this triangle of the tetrahedron with this stick. Again, rotating the sticks around in the same way as we rotate the corners around to get the tetrahedron gives back all the sticks of the 6-axis racks mechanism. Okay, but there's something different with 6-axis racks. None of the others have a core with gears. Isn't this cheating? Shouldn't I have done it with just sliding racks like all of the other mechanisms? Well, sure, it is cheating in a sense, but let me show you why I had to do it this way. Since everything is so symmetric, we can just look at a small part, say this stick crossing these two sticks here. If you want to have one stick mesh into a second stick, at right angles, then you put these diagonal racks on the sticks. And I've got the same pattern on the back of the stick as on the front to make it more easy to see what's going on. Thanks to my collaborator, Sabeto Matsumoto, for that idea. And as you can see, this is working great. As I move one stick, the other one moves. The issue comes when you want a third stick to also mesh with the first stick at right angles. And what happens is that the two sticks move in the same direction. Which is great if that's what you want, but in the real thing, the two sticks have to move in opposite directions. and the directions of motion of the sticks are all fixed by the symmetry. We can't just swap the direction that only one of the sticks moves without breaking everything. So that means that racks directly meshing with racks doesn't work here. The other thing you might try is to have the direction of the diagonal racks swap halfway along the stick. So this works, but you can see that it gets stuck after only just a little bit of motion. And what's going on here is that when this stick is hitting the changeover point between the two directions of the diagonal racks, you can't go any further. So this works, but I would only get a very small amount of motion in the overall mechanism. However, with a gear connecting the three sticks together, everything moves in the correct direction and it just works. So yes, it's cheating to use gears in a core, but whatever, I made the rules so I can break them too. In tetrahedral racks, there are triples of sticks that all move in the same way, so I connected each of those triples together with these end caps to make the four parts. In six-axis racks, there are pairs of sticks that move in the same direction as each other. So these two sticks here always move in the same direction as a unit. And there are six of these pairs, which is where the name six-axis racks comes from. There are six axes of motion, if you like. I could have connected these together like I did in the other mechanisms, but it works fine as it is, so I haven't bothered. And depending on how you connect them together, well, okay, so maybe you could have like a bar across here that would connect these two sticks together into a single rigid object, but then you'd probably have a bar across here as well. And these two bars would interact with each other. So they'd crash into each other sort of at this point. It would stop you from pushing all the way through here. On the other hand, having a bar across here would stop you from pushing it through the core. So at the moment, there's nothing stopping me from just sort of pushing this further. And all the sticks will fall out of the core. And it was a huge pain to get all the sticks lined up the same distance into the core as each other. So I really don't want them to come out. But I do want to talk about the core on its own, so I guess I have to. All right, this is the core. And the interesting thing here is how to print this on a filament-based printer. So obviously the gears have to be printed separately and then attached to the core, but maybe you would want to print the core as a single unit. Well, no matter which way you orient this, there's always going to be some sort of overhang, and so you need to build support structure underneath the overhang to support it as it's being printed. And then you have to clean the support structure off and it makes the surface finish not so nice. Anyway, it's annoying. I didn't want to use support if I could avoid it. The other thing is that the axles around which the gears rotate, I wanted those axles to be printed vertically. The reason for this is that 3D printers, filament-based 3D printers, are more accurate at horizontal shapes than sort of vertical shapes. And so I want the axles to be as round as possible, and I want the printer to be printing those circles horizontally rather than at some other angle. For both of these reasons, both the overhangs and the axle direction, it made more sense to print multiple parts and then bolt them together to make the core. Even better if the bolts that hold the gears on also hold the core together. Well, let's take the bolts out and see what it looks like. It turns out that the core stays together even without the bolts, a little bit of wobble here, because it's a copy of the Star Burr puzzle. Let me take it apart. And with this orientation, the axle gets to be printed vertically and I don't need any support. My collaborator Saul Schleimer came up with this idea. Here's a more standard version of the Star Burr puzzle. Maybe you've seen this kind of thing before without all of the extra stuff. And again, if you can remember how to take it apart, you sort of grasp opposite triples and then they slide apart like that and then fall into pieces. If you want to play with this kinetic sculpture yourself, there's a link to the 3D printing files in the description. Sorry for making you solve the Star Burr puzzle in the core. It's pretty fiddly to put together. And I'm even more sorry if you want to get the sticks lined up the same distance into the core as each other. If anybody figures out an easy way to do that, please let me know. All right, this is six-axis racks. Thanks for watching.